In other words, we have a responsibility to lead. Outside this Senate chamber, you can hear hammering. We have workers that are hammering on the platform for the inauguration ceremony. It'll take several months to do it, but it'll be done right. In 65 days, Donald Trump will step onto that platform. For 4 years, he will yield the loudest and most powerful microphone in the world. But even as those workers hammer away on Trump's platform, even as we as leaders accept the results of this election, we must also give voice to those who are afraid, because there are many that are afraid. Indeed, a majority of Americans oppose Donald Trump. Many of my Republican colleagues in this chamber oppose Trump. They weren't alone. Trump will be the first president to take office, having lost a popular vote by 2 million. Every day for the past week, a majority of American voters have awakened to a difficult reality. Not only did that man who lost a popular vote win the election, but his election sparked a rise in hate crimes, violence. Since Election Day, the Southern Poverty Law Center has reported hundreds of incidents of harassment and intimidation. Last count, 315 from their calculations. Overwhelmingly, the hateful acts at a Muslim, at a Hispanic, at a African American, at a woman, at a LGBT, at a Semitic, and at a Asian. I've heard these stories from friends and family. My and my wife's Nevada physician is a Pakistani American of Muslim faith. We think so much of him. We've known each other for 35 years. The day after the election, my friend was in a restaurant in Las Vegas having dinner. A man, in approaching him in a threatening manner, said, "Where are you from?" He said, "Where are you from?" The man that approached him said, "I'm local." The doctor said, "So am I." That same night, in another restaurant in Las Vegas, a Pakistani physician was having dinner. A man walked up to him in the same manner, said, "Where are you from?" He said, "I'm from Pakistan." He said, "Why don't you go back?" One of my staffers has a daughter in middle school. I've known that little girl since she was a little baby. The day after the election, the principal addressed the entire student body on the school's PA system because the two incidents had occurred that he wanted to talk to them about. In one instance, a boy yelled at a Latina student, telling her that he was glad she was going to be deported now that Trump was president. In another instance, a boy was sent home for yelling the most derogatory, hateful term at an African-American student. The boy justified himself by saying he used that language now that Trump was president. In Spokane, Washington, the Martin Luther King Center there was defaced with the same hateful word. Those are only a few examples of what people close to me have related. But these kinds of disturbing accounts have been heard across America. I have here, Mr. President, a compilation of these incidents. One is from NBC News. Another is from another publication. Hundreds of incidents in the last few days, and I would ask that be made part of the record. That was just entered into the record, those references made are awful, they're hateful, they're frightening, they're scary. I invite any of my colleagues to read these horrible acts, and I invite any senator, Democrat or Republican, to come right down to this floor today and defend any one of them. These examples of hate and prejudice. I don't believe anyone in this chamber wants to defend the hateful acts that are being committed in President-elect Trump's name. They lead to one unavoidable conclusion. Many of our fellow Americans believe that Trump's election validates the kind of bullying, aggressive behavior Trump modeled on a daily basis. How can we teach our children that bragging about sexual assault is abhorrent if we rush into the arms of a man who dismissed his locker room talk? If we fail to hold Trump accountable, we all bear a major responsibility for normalizing his behavior. Here's a letter from a seventh grader from Rhode Island. She wrote it the day after the election, and I direct quote from the letter. Seventh grader. I'm extremely scared, especially being a woman of color, that the president of the country that I was born and live in is making me feel unsafe when I actually shouldn't feel unsafe. It's even scarier because this man who is now the president of the United States of America has said such rude, ignorant, and disrespectful things about women and all different types of people and is now in charge of our country. I want to feel safe in my country, but I no longer can feel safe with someone like Donald Trump leading the country. Close quote, end of letter. Our president is supposed to make people feel safe. But on Wednesday, a seventh grade girl woke feeling frightened to be a woman of color in America because Donald Trump was president-elect. If we ignore her voice and other voices, this seventh grader will be left to conclude that we as a nation find her fear acceptable. How do we show her that she doesn't have to be afraid? The first step is facing reality. No matter how hard the rest of us work, the main responsibility lies within the man who inspired the fear. President-elect Trump must act immediately to make America, like that seventh grade girl, feel that they are welcome in his America. Healing the wounds he will take more than words. Talk is cheap and tweets are cheaper. Healing wounds is going to take action. But so far, Mr. President, rather than healing these wounds, Trump's actions have deepened them. In one of his very first, if not his first official act, he appointed a man seen as a champion of white supremacy as a number one strategist in the White House. Number one. Everybody else is under him. According to CNN, and I quote, white nationalist leaders are praising Donald Trump's decision to name Stephen Bannon as his chief strategist, close quote. In the same article, white nationalist leaders say they see Bannon, quote, as an advocate for policies they favor, close quote. And according to the Poverty Law Center, Bannon, quote, was a main driver between Breitbart becoming a white ethno-nationalist propaganda mill, close quote. When asked to comment on Bannon's hiring, KKK leader David Duke told CNN, again a quote, I think that's excellent, close quote. Court filing stated that Bannon said, again another quote, that he doesn't like Jews and that he doesn't like the way they raise their kids to be whiny brats and that he didn't want his girls to go to school with Jews, close quote. That's court document. By placing a champion of white supremacists a step away from the Oval Office, what message does Trump send to the young girl who woke up Wednesday morning in Rhode Island afraid to be a woman of color in America? It's not a message of healing. If Trump is serious about seeking unity, the first thing he should do is rescind his appointment with Steve Bannon. Rescind him. Don't do it. Think about this. Don't do it. As long as a champion of racial division is a step away from the Oval Office, it will be impossible to take Trump's efforts to heal the nation seriously. So I say to Donald Trump, take responsibility. Rise to the dignity of the office of President of the United States instead of hiding behind your Twitter account and show America that racism, bullying, and bigotry